Mr. Speaker, sir, before the House rose yesterday, I was expressing myself mainly on three points. With your permission, sir, I will recapitulate briefly the points I made yesterday to get into our sequence. I was referring to the necessity of a concerted effort on the part of the government to devise and introduce a scheme by which the urge of the younger people of our nation for military training may be satisfied. The charm and fascination which draw the young people, especially boys of school-going age, for military drills and military discipline, for parades and maneuvers, are well known. This, sir, is a precious treasure of the government and of the nation. It should be put to the best use by the country. Our experience in the past has, however, been that this urge unfortunately was exploited by certain interested parties for ulterior motives, but that it can be put to the best use for the nation cannot be denied, and as such, I believe that if the government devises a scheme whereby either through some suitable military officers or through the police officers or even through other qualified persons in various states, a drive is made to train our young people in the art of bearing arms and going in for military drills and discipline, it will be very fitting for the needs of the times. Secondly, I referred to the integration of the state's forces into the overall setup of the Indian Army. After the accomplishment of the marvelous and almost impossible task of integration of as many as 5-6 to princely states into the various provinces or into states unions, it is only to be expected that the state's forces, which are scattered over all these states, should be incorporated into the bigger unit of the Indian Army. They should form part and parcel of it. As such, it is only proper that there should have been some provision in the defense budget for that purpose, so that a beginning could have been made in this direction. Thirdly, I was referring to the mass of prejudice and superstition that prevails in certain foreign countries about our social customs and institutions. It has to be painfully observed that during the course of the slavery of 200 years of our country, a ruthlessly distorted picture of our country was presented to the world. Therefore, it is only proper that all the harm and damage that has been done to our reputation by notorious writers should be undone now, and a concerted effort should be made that all the prejudice that exists in foreign countries about our manners and social customs, about our culture and civilization, should be removed. It would be not only in the best interests of our nation and country and in keeping with our prestige, but it would also pave the way for international peace, amity and goodwill. In this connection, I would suggest that the education department should publish literature and do propaganda in order to remove all these various myths and fancies and superstitions that reign supreme today in foreign countries about us. Coming to another aspect of the function of publicity and information on the part of our government, I would like to refer to publicity within our own country. In order that our democracy may prove successful, it is necessary that the common man must be made more intelligent. He must be made aware of his various responsibilities, rights and privileges. It is therefore very essential that from village to village and from town to town, there should be a network of our publicity organization which should be used to educate the masses. It is unfortunate that the few papers that there are in this country, I say few, looking to the population of the country and the number of newspapers are only available in the town. Even the benefits and advantages of the broadcasting system are restricted to the towns and cities. It could have been planned that a number of radio sets to begin with, say 1,000 or 2,000, are distributed to make a modest beginning in Delhi. They could have been supplied free of cost to the villages and could have been so organized that all the broadcasting programs meant for the rural population could be listened to by them. I understand that some steps have been taken in this direction, but it is only proper that if out of every 4 men in the United States or in the United Kingdom, one possesses a radio or a motor car, it is necessary that in at least every village in our country, there should be a radio set. This bill particularly applies to drugs and food industries. Let us examine the present position regarding the chemical and pharmaceutical industry. 30 years ago, the pharmaceutical industry was merely doing processing, but there has been a considerable development in this regard. In 2010, the production came to rupees 500 crores. So, this bill tries to give capital punishment for food offenses. My experience of the working of the rationing laws in my state has been that the majority of the people who are arrested and convicted for these offenses are poor people who carry small quantities of grains from one place to another for their own living, and these people are put in prison and harassed. I have not yet known of any large number of really big merchants who are really responsible for the black market in these food grains being brought to book. This bill which we are passing and in which the punishment has been raised to 3 years and in which it has also been provided that the couriers by means of which this smuggling takes place should also be forfeited will not achieve the desired result. I very much doubt if many trucks and other big vehicles will be confiscated. What will really happen is that many bullock carts of the kisans will be confiscated and they will be harassed. That is my practical experience from the interior of the Gorakhpur district, where lies the border between UP and Bihar and where I